This video has been supported by JLCPCB. Hey guys, what do you all think about Geiger counters? I think they are pretty cool. Simple, cheap and robust. And with a diverse sensitivity to gamma, X-rays, alpha and beta particles, they are perfectly suited for personal protective equipment, telling you when something spicy is in the air and roughly how worried you should be about it. Like this cute personal dosimeter that doesn't care about type or energy of radiation. It only beeps at you when it detects too much. I wanted to make this look like the world's hottest banana, but the peel is actually a surprisingly good radiation shield. So anyway, a Geiger-Müller detector is cool. But I hear you ask, it's way too practical and simple. Isn't there something more crazy, fancy, precise and sensitive out there? An 8.5-digit radiation detector, so to speak. Of course there is, and I just so happen to have an example right here. This is an old, broken scintillation crystal, a doped sodium iodide, that when struck by ionizing radiation starts emitting a little bit of light. Normally only a handful of photons, this is quite an extreme demonstration by BioNerd23. To detect these infinitesimal few photon events, a photomultiplier tube is used that bounces our small signal to higher and higher potentials until ultimately it becomes measurable. This is the same combination of crystal and PMT in a less broken and easier to handle format. The resulting sensitivity of such a detector exceeds the one of the good old Geiger-Müller tube by far. This is just normal background radiation from naturally occurring radon gases and from space. My apartment is not that contaminated, I hope. There is much more to say about scintillation detectors, but today I would like to focus on that cosmic radiation. There are a lot of sources of particle radiation from space. A few are known and understood to some degree, like solar flares which eject tons of high-velocity particles into outer space, or distant supernovae which eject even more. But there are also more mysterious objects like quasars or radio galaxies being suspected of throwing light nuclei at us. These rare, extra-galactical, ultra-high-energy cosmic rays travel mind-boggling distances, and for very, very long times, only to find a rather unspectacular end in our atmosphere, where they collide with molecules. On Earth, we can use a multi-million dollar detector to sense the muons, the shrapnel from these collisions though, and maybe learn something about the mysterious, ancient origins of the primary cosmic rays. Not everybody has a few million dollars and the room for such a detector though. And that's finally what we are going to tackle today. We are going to build a Cosmic Pi, a Raspberry Pi-based muon detector, developed by a team of scientists at CERN. Aimed to create the world's largest open-source distributed cosmic ray telescope, meaning that one such low-cost detector is just going to be a single internet-connected pixel in a large global array that will see and report all of the interesting cosmic particle incidents. This presentation is a bit outdated. The Arduino has been replaced with a much cooler STM32 in the current version. The Open Hardware Repository is an absolute treasure chest, where the last videos HPM7177, the Cosmic Pi and many other awesome projects are hosted. This video's sponsor JLCPCB has made some beautiful circuit boards for this project. Right now they have a special offer extending their legendary $2 price to 4-layer PCBs. Dimensions for these are limited. The power an engineer gains when switching from 2 to 4 layers, however, is not. The 4-layer specimen in front of me right now is too large to qualify for that special offer. But JLCPCB is still by far the least expensive manufacturer for them. For some of the fine-pitched components on here, a solder paste stencil was absolutely mandatory. This high-quality laser-cut stainless steel sheet was only $7 extra, and it didn't increase the 4-day production time of my order as a whole. As always, I'm very happy with JLCPCB's cost, speed and quality. And if you need some cheap 4-layer PCBs yourself, check out the link in the video description and give them a try. I'm going to give away the remaining 4 boards on Patreon if anybody wants to participate and make their own Cosmic Pi. These days all electronic components seem to be out of stock everywhere. So I was forced to purchase some cheap dev boards from eBay to harvest an LSM9 DS1 IMU. and a Bosch BME-280 ambient pressure sensor. But under normal circumstances, this project is based on easily available standard parts. There are only four components with slightly elevated difficulty. The two silicon photomultipliers from KTEC, which are available in the manufacturer's online shop. And these two bars of chocolate, also known as plastic scintillator slabs.
What?
Which you might be able to buy, or you can just try and make them DIY. My friend Giga Becquerel has done some research in the area and published a successful recipe. I'm going to link that blog post below. Obviously, these two pairs of silicon photomultiplier and scintillator are doing the same job as the crystal and vacuum tube I've shown in the beginning. Only they are much cheaper, they don't need a few kilovolt to work, and the geometry of a plastic scintillator is much easier to control than that of a crystal. We do want a precise geometry for this application, so that each pixel has the same area, and the same likelihood of catching those muons. They are wrapped in aluminium foil and black tape to keep out normal everyday photons that aren't coming from a detection. This double stack of detectors is used to filter the counts. We don't want to know about any old stray radiation from radon gases or spicy bananas. We only care about those muons for now that tend to come from above and would set off both detectors at roughly the same time. Assembly-wise, nothing too crazy. We've got some outside world interfacing at the bottom. Two DC-to-DC converters at the top, which generate roughly 30 volt to bias the silicon photomultipliers. Those I don't have to populate myself, because one of the Cosmic Pi team members has very generously given me that whole SIPM carrier module, ready to plug in. In the center there are some amplifiers and a shaping stage that stretches out the ultra-short impulses from the detector to make them measurable more easily. In the upper left corner there's a discrete trigger circuit that detects these literal coincidences, or simultaneous detections on both SIPM channels, without leaning too much on the microcontroller resources. With the current version of the software, I think the STM32F401 has plenty and to spare. At the time of making this video, it only has to talk to some environmental and GPS sensors in the bottom left corner. But who knows, maybe they will add some advanced functionality in the future. Some crude spectroscopy maybe, warning people about elevated radon levels in their houses, for example. On the right we are going to plug in a Raspberry Pi, which will host a time series database and a Grafana to visualize all the sensor data. If you enable that, it will connect to the internet and report all your data to a central MQTT server. There's also an ESP8266 footprint for an even lower cost version that doesn't log anything locally but only reports to that central MQTT server. I hope the global chip shortage won't last much longer, but while it does, there's yet another job for the miniware hotplate. My bigger one is temporarily unavailable. Ah, so good. Plastic IC packages are often able to absorb humidity, not a huge problem in normal operating temperatures. But when they are heated rapidly in a reflow cycle, for example, the rapidly expanding water can literally explode some ICs. So especially with these harvested sensors, it's a good idea to dry them for a while, at their maximum storage temperature. I was casually scrolling through the BME-280 datasheet, while the deep frying was already in full swing. Then I noticed that vapor phase reflow soldering is not allowed for that part, and neither are liquid solvent cleaners. Oh well, too bad. The aluminium foil wrapped scintillation detectors are pretty light tight. But as I said before, we are talking about detection and amplification of a handful of photons. So I thought it would be best to completely black out the Raspberry Pi. Little did I know that the active LED can also be disabled in software. Oops. Oh well. Looking good. The final few assembly steps are pretty straightforward now. The whole thing goes into a nice, chunky, light-tight Hammond enclosure. That is, it used to be light-tight until somebody decided to CNC machine some cutouts into the front panel. That someone must have also decided to 3D print some light guides for the status LEDs. and to give him some raccoon makeup against crosstalk. The SIPM carrier module is plugged in and screwed down onto the mainboard. I've 3D printed two of these holders which will support the heavy scintillator slabs mechanically a bit. This is one of those exquisitely rare moments where a prepared front panel actually fits the internals. This has to be completely light tight, I'm afraid. Oh no, incompatibility of gaffer tape and gloves, what a tough decision. Ugh, I bet I'm leaving skin cells and fingerprints everywhere now. An external GPS antenna with an unobstructed view of the sky would be good. But while waiting for that to be delivered, I also got it to work with a short DIY dipole. 12 volt power and we are ready to flash. The software experience is probably going to change significantly, so I'm not going to go into too much detail here. Basically, I downloaded and flashed an SD card image, as one does for every other Raspberry Pi installation. This one comes prepared with a few bash scripts in the home folder. Initially, I would run an update firmware which pulls the latest version from GitHub. Afterwards, running flashpy.bash will flash the fresh firmware onto my only STM32, or brick it, then it'd be trash. If everything went well, the right LED will start to indicate muon coincidence events immediately after power on. And depending on your GPS antenna location, the left LED will start to indicate a GPS lock in a few minutes. I'm not making popcorn here, that's rain on the window. Meanwhile, the database and Grafana will have finished starting and are beginning to fill with our first cosmic rays. We can also see all the data that the STM32 is putting out in a plain text format, but my GPS coordinates are in there, so I'm going to have to pixel that. And this is it pretty much, our local cosmic Pi pixel detecting an average of 2.5 muons per second, in correlation with a lot of environmental data. At 6 o'clock we are suddenly seeing an outlier with 11 detections per second. If there were a few more pixels in the neighborhood, we could compare results and see if it's just a glitch in mine or a real interesting incident. This is what's possible when more than one sensor are networked. So if you find this kind of stuff interesting, I would definitely recommend building one. It was a lot of fun and I learned a few things. For example, how wonderfully an STM32 and a Raspberry Pi can work together using only 4 GPIO pins. No doubt that recipe is going to find its way into a few of my own projects. Finally, here's a look at the shaped output signals of both detectors. I think the analog circuitry in here is maintaining proportionality, meaning that a higher energy detection will cause a higher impulse amplitude on the signal. Both of these signals are connected to the STM32. It might be hard for a mere microcontroller to catch all of these and to measure their precise amplitudes. But theoretically, there is still a bit more data in here that might be interesting to store. Here's some data that might be interesting to you. Keysight University Live is starting right now. It's a free online event with test gear tips and tricks, interviews with industry experts and a lot of prizes to win. For example, this cute DSOX1204, its bigger 6 GHz brother, or $300,000 worth of other test equipment prizes. They don't have any muon detectors per se, but I'm not sure if there's any kind of radiation that can escape their FieldFox handheld microwave analyzer. Somebody is going to win that beauty too. So sign up now for Keysight University Live and subscribe to their YouTube channel where the first few winners will be drawn today. I'm wishing you a lot of luck.